Welcome everyone, welcome to UCL. Welcome to this very special event. I'm Thiago Mata. I teach here at UCL at the Department of Science and Technology Studies. I'm also a leader of a project that's researching economic journalism, historically and sociologically. And this roundtable today, this very special event, opens a two-day conference where we'll be looking at the history of The Economist. Now, The Economist is many things to many people. It is a magazine, although they like to call it a newspaper. It is the carry-on item of the Global Traveler. It's a champion of liberalism. It's a provocateur in its weekly coverage of worldly affairs. And as I discovered in 2001, when I came to London to study for a degree at the LSE, in some quarters of the city, it's the house paper. At the LSE in that quarter of the Strand, The Economist was always on show and always part of the conversation. So the many meanings and the many lives of The Economist are some of the features that draw us scholars to it. Another feature that draws us in is longevity. In its first issue in September 1843, it was printed on its front page, a political, commercial, agricultural, and free trade journal. A half century later, it had become a weekly Commercial Times, Banker's Gazette, and Railway Monitor. And to subtitle that subtitle, it was also a political, literary, and general newspaper. Now, today the publication does not signpost its reinvention as bluntly as it did in the 19th century, but its focus, its attitude, its reach have continued to change and are changing still. The special event of this morning is a unique opportunity to understand this singularly plural publication. At our roundtable are the persons that carry, and one of them still carries, the ultimate, the highest responsibility in the design of The Economist. They are its editors. Now, I won't introduce them, but I'll leave that privilege to our moderator, but I will introduce our moderator. Ruth Dudley Edwards is the author of
massive.
Don't drop it on your foot.
900 plus pages?
Something terrible, yeah.
Yes.
Oops. it's about to fall over.
No, it won't fall. Physics won't let it. This monumental history of The Economist at its 150th anniversary is one of her 11 nonfiction books. To these, she has added another 12 fiction titles. Her novels are crime stories, her nonfiction work mostly biographies, and you can see that she's drawn to characters at their best and at their worst. For those like me interested in the history of British media, she's the author of Newspaper Man, a paired biography of Cudlip, Cecil Harmsworth King, and how they turned The Mirror into a top-selling title and founded a newspaper empire. That's fine, I'm going to just, I got two lines left. Her most recent nonfiction book is Aftermath, the
Omar,
Bombing and the Family's Pursuit of Justice. Her latest crime novel is Killing the Emperors, a satire on the corrupt world of conceptual art. Thank you for accepting our invitation, and I'm anticipating a fascinating discussion.
Thank you, Thiago. Do you want to give me that, perhaps, since we're short on here? Does this work? It does?
Yeah, it does work.
Right. Well, thank you for that introduction. I owe a lot to The Economist, including using it as a murder weapon in one of my crime novels. I mean the book. You can see why. I also owe it some inspiration for my last satirical novel on conceptual art, because I always thought the art in The Economist was absolutely dreadful. And enormously pretentious, but otherwise I was rather fond of the institution. I called the book The Pursuit of Reason because I found The Economist an immensely English institution. I'm Irish and I always have an outsider's take on things. And I know particularly from many conferences on Northern Ireland and various such events, there's a particular baffled look the English have when everybody around them is being irrational and they just can't understand why. Surely Can't we make them see? Can't we show them the facts? Can't we give them the background? Can't we make them understand? And of course, that's a very tough thing to do, as we know, looking at the world. So I called it the pursuit of reason. I didn't call it the vain pursuit of reason, but that's really what rationalists experience all their lives. So I'm going to ask these eminent people to introduce themselves, not as they are now, except for Zanny, but as they were when they became, because she's still the same person that she was when she became editor a few months ago, or nearly. I'd like to ask them to talk about the person they were when they got the job and how they got the job. So, Andrew, you are the first. You got the job in 1974, is that right? What was Andrew Knight like?
That's for others to say, isn't it? Well, I was astonished to become editor of The Economist. It simply wasn't anything, wasn't on my map at all. It was a very difficult time, because it's hard to remember now that that we'd had indecisive general elections, rather similar to the recent one in 2010, but in very difficult circumstances, economically and politically, and we had a very indeterminate government, which had defeated a conservative government, which had mishandled its own destiny and its own mission quite poorly. And I hadn't been living in the UK for quite some time, which I suppose was quite gave one a fresh point of view. But I was only 34 years old and much younger than most of the people who I was working with. Although I think my colleagues would say that one of the great things about The Economist is that it's edited by and largely peopled by a very young cohort of people who have a view and who are very thirsty for knowledge and thirsty to get knowledge across. I think the biggest single danger of any young editor of The Economist, and we were all young when we've done it, and you can see in Zanny Minton Beddoes that, you know, we're all young people. Well, but I think the real danger is that you're in danger of becoming a rock star, because you're immediately lionized, and everybody wants to, so to speak, get to know you and influence you and talk to you. And it's completely bogus, of course, because basically you are leading a team of people, in my case, at least half a dozen of them and probably more, but certainly visibly half a dozen of them were a great deal more brilliant than I was, were absolute leaders in their field in economic policy. We were talking before we came in here about Norman McRae, one of the great geniuses of economic policy making, was my deputy. The foreign editor was legendary with a very, very specific point of view on many, many things. And I could run through a whole gamut of people. And I would think all of us have felt that in one form or another, that we weren't the cleverest people in the room. What we were trying to do is to bring together the cleverest people in the room, one. And two, I think the most absolute, the thing I would resort to if it comes to questions over and over again, you'll hear me resorting to, and I suspect that my colleagues would say the same, is that The Economist is not about personality, it's about issues. It's about what are the great issues of the day and where do we stand on them. There is a danger in The Economist, and here I'm probably commenting without meaning to adversely sometimes on my successors, and certainly it happened in my day as well, of using the word must or should. It's a terrible danger because we have this almost unique situation in the world of being this anonymous newspaper which people respect and turn to, which is a wonderful thing. We keep on telling people that they should do this, or they must do this, or they ought to do this. And in my day, and I'm sure others too, I tried to get that out. The point is to try and see the issues and to try and assess them without telling people what they've got to do. And yet it should become apparent what we think they ought to do. The most striking example of that very, very early on in my time was when the person that I mentioned a moment ago, Norman McRae, there was, it's a bit like we've had recently here, there was a huge oil crisis. The price of oil, led by the Iranians at the time, was quintupled overnight. And OPEC was formed, more or less, during that time, and they had an absolute stranglehold on our economies. And there was a tremendous, everybody thought, a shortage of oil. And there was rationing, there was semi-rationing, and certainly price was rationing it. Norman McRae persuaded me that we should carry a cover which would only have words on it, and the words were the coming energy glut. The trouble we got into was staggering. The government and all the oil companies, particularly Shell, did everything they could to discredit us because it was contrary to every policy that was being practiced and every piece of journalistic rhetoric that was being practiced. And of course, within 2 or 3 years, I can't be too precise, the oil price was plunging, and there was indeed an energy glut. Why was there an energy glut? There was an energy glut because if you quintuple the price of something, everybody stops consuming it and everybody else starts producing it. So there's suddenly more oil and less consumption. That was the beginning of, that was when Americans first started going over to smaller cars. If you look at the pictures of what cars looked like, the gas guzzlers in America at the time. So that even now, there's the great big 4x4 cars in America, even they have quite efficient energy, quite efficient engines, whereas at the time, nobody even thought about it. So you've got this huge migration to more efficient consumption of oil on the one hand, and vast increase in exploration and pumping out of oil. So of course, Norman McRae simply saw that. That is the way to lead opinion. It's not by saying everybody must save on energy or everybody should do this. It's by, and I think this is the core of The Economist, is to this day, is pointing out through analysis and through observation what the issues are. If I think of the, and then I must shut up. I very much regret, hugely regret, I'm 75 years old. I just would love to be 35 and oust Zanny from her job and do it. Because at the time, I thought that it could never... I couldn't imagine a more extraordinary period for issues than when I was editing, or luckily with Rupert, because Rupert came on as our economics editor afterwards, which was just amazing. And I'll tell you a story about that because I can't resist it in a minute. I couldn't imagine it, and for years afterwards I thought, oh, I was so lucky. I was there when the whole energy thing started. I was there when the change to Friedmanite monetarist economics came in. I was there when Thatcher revolutionized, for good or ill, I happen to think for good, on balance, the UK economy. I was there, we endorsed indeed, and there was a very small minority on the paper who thought that we should. We endorsed Reagan for the presidency, and he turned out to be, in many ways, a great president who restored faith inside America and outside it after some terrible disasters. So we had Thatcher, Reagan, energy, monetarist economics, and above all, maybe above all, we had, obviously, the Middle East going on and on and on in horrifying ways, and yet in some good ways. We had the lead-up to Mandela, We had, above all, what led up after my time, but the whole Cold War struggle. Now, I couldn't imagine a time when such a conference of issues could possibly be, and yet look at today, far more interesting, far more dangerous, far more worrying, and far more exalting also because of the extraordinary increasing wealth that I would argue by and large a capitalist system has brought to wealth and well-being to poor areas of the world, never mind the rich areas where a few people probably have much more wealth than they should do, but by and large there has been an enormous spread of well-being, of health and wealth, and it's got far further to go. But you just think of the issues today, and they make mine seem pitifully, at the time, once in my time, pitifully minor. So for a young person coming in then, this was overwhelming, and I was just very, very lucky to have some extraordinary people. I had a predecessor, my immediate predecessor, called Alistair Burnett, a marvelous editor. I always remember the story of when he was recruited onto The Economist. He was interviewed by the editor of the day, Donald Tyerman, and asked to write a trial piece. And he wrote the trial piece, and somebody in the room at the time said that when Donald Tyerman, the then editor, read this trial piece by Alistair Burnett, he laughed with joy because it was so beautifully written, and he put it straight in the paper. I was first introduced to Rupert Pennant-Rea, now chairman of The Economist, and an outstanding editor in saving his presence, by a mutual friend who knew him when he was at the Bank of England or doing work for the Bank of England. He came, I interviewed him, and I asked him to do a trial piece. And Rupert has this extraordinary habit of writing everything in longhand, but so far as I can see, at 3, 4, and 5 in the morning. When I came in at 8:30 or 9, the piece was already on my desk, and I put it straight in the paper, and that was it. I didn't actually laugh with joy, but it's what I felt like. And there are certain people who just have it, who just know how to write a piece, and I think Bill and Rupert and Zanny would endorse this. It's a real cohort of those on The Economist, so that even if you're a young editor out of your depth, surrounded by issues which you find very, very difficult to cope with, you've got this extraordinary team pulling together. End of story.
Thank you, Andrew. That was a great start. Rupert, what were you like, and did you have a terribly dreary time as far as issues were concerned?
Well, unlike Andrew, becoming editor was absolutely on my map. I was very keen to be editor. Almost from the day I arrived, I had no desire to go into journalism at all, no expectation of becoming a journalist. I was a economist working in a central bank and ploughing away on all sorts of rather, when I look back, tedious aspects of monetary policy. And I got this opportunity and jumped at it. And the first week I was there, I thought, my goodness, why didn't I come here earlier? And the answer was that I tried. When I was doing a master's in economics, I wrote to the editor, whose name I didn't even know, saying, could I please have a job? I'm just the sort of bloke you're looking for, I assure you, although I have nothing to prove that assertion. Far too reasonably, he wrote back, pointing this out, and said no. And that was Alistair. When I was 22 or whatever I was. So I did have a stab, and then having been rudely rebuffed, I thought, well, that's that, I'm not going to try again. Never thought of it again until suddenly I had lunch by great good fortune with the economics editor at the time, Sarah Hogg, did the trial piece that Andrew described, and there I was. And when I became editor,
it was Bill, yeah. It was Bill and Sarah.
I didn't know Sarah.
Yeah. And I became editor 9 years later, and still couldn't believe how wonderful it all was. And I've carried on feeling that ever since, really. It is undoubtedly the best place in the world to work. And I've worked in a lot of other places since and before, and there is nowhere like it. It has an atmosphere, a collegiality, a rather tedious, many-syllabled word, but it captures it, a sense of fun and enjoyment, a sense of shared endeavor, a sense of high intelligence. And anyone who works there is very blessed. And if you are editor, you are blessed many times over. And I think we will all go to our graves knowing that those were our golden years, undoubtedly. So, yes, I had a wonderful, wonderful opportunity. I inherited, like Andrew did, some incredible people, including the two people he mentioned, the deputy editor, the foreign editor, and others who were extremely clear about the nature of the character of The Economist, about the kind of audience we were aiming at, about the issues that they wanted to concentrate on. And so to some degree, when you become editor, you find yourself just tapping the hoop a bit to make sure it keeps going. Later, you develop more initiatives and become probably quite irritating to the people who've been there a long time. But and then you have the other great task, of course, which is recruiting the people coming along behind, the younger ones, the people who may one day be the stars of the future. So all of those challenges suddenly start crowding in on you, and you find that actually the idea that you're ever going to write again, actually write for the paper, that recedes further and further into the distance. And it's only when you say, hang on a moment, I quite enjoy writing, and I do have a view on this, that you start to pull back some of the ability to write yourself. But in the first 6 months I was editor, I didn't think I was allowed near anything other than final editing. And of course there you suddenly have your dream come true, because you are the final word. And I always used to say to my colleagues, this place is 95% an anarchic democracy and 5% the most profound dictatorship. And I'm the 5%. So we'll go all the way up to the point of discussion and so on. But we do have a deadline. We do have to decide, and I will decide. And I think on the whole, that is an atmosphere and a way of operating that everybody approves of. Yeah, Andrew just said, what about anonymity? And I think
it gives you the authority to be the fact.
It does. It does. You know, if you were changing some star writer's cherished prose and his name or her name was above it, you'd have endless fights. But because it's The Economist and because you are the editor, it's fine. Everybody accepts in the end that you can change stuff in the name of something bigger than anyone. And that's a huge plus. So, I mean, I could go on for not just this morning, but for weeks, but I won't. I'll stop.
Well, we'll come back to you, because highlights and lowlights of your time, we'd like to hear as well. Andrew just had a story about his recruitment.
Oh, gosh, this is shocking. I'd wanted to be on The Economist for ages, and I'd been on The Investors Chronicle, and I was finally introduced by Brian Beatham, actually, and I was interviewed by one of the more brilliant men I've ever worked with, called Fred Hirsch, who died of motor neurone disease very young, but he was an unbelievably brilliant economist, international liquidity economist. More or less invented things called SDR, special drawing rights, which were a big thing in the IMF, and so on and so forth. And I was interviewed by him. And at the beginning of the interview, he said, well, what are you earning? And I said, well, I'm earning £1,250 a year on The Economist. on the Investors Chronicle. He said, right. And that's fine. He said, if we decide to take you, we won't pay you any more than that. I said, no, that's fine. £1,250 at the time was perfectly decent. You could live on it, salary sharing, a flat, etc. And so that was that. And then the interview, and I got into worse and worse and worse shape. Every question he asked was worse than the previous one. And he finally asked me a question, and I floundered all over the place. And he said, Mr. Knight, I don't think much of that answer. And I said, but what do you expect for £1,250? And I was in. I was in because it's like when you apply to UCL or to another great university, the tutor is actually looking for somebody who's going to be fun to work with and be there, you know, to an extent. So anyway, that's how I got in, basically. And people have said when I've told that story in the family before, I'm extremely nervous. If I'm shaking today, by the way, you should realize that this is not because it's UCL, it's not because it's about The Economist, it's not because of all these important issues. It's because my adorable, darling daughter who lives in Los Angeles is sitting in the room and she's never heard me speak before and I'm terrified. But anyway, that's how I joined, and it was a disaster. And poor Bill. Bill applied from Magdalen College, Oxford, through one of the great tutors that Magdalen has ever had, who used to supply wonderful, wonderful people to us. I could name almost half a dozen great people who came to us. The only one that I refused to give a job to after three interviews was Bill Emmott.
My revenge is coming.
He did. I let him in finally.
Actually, just before you start, Bill, this point about the recruiter in Magdalen, Oxford, and three out of four of them were at Oxford. He was the outsider, Rupert, he's from Trinity College Dublin.
And there is an absentee who was the four out of five. We're missing John Micklethwaite, who is not able to be here.
And two Amphifordians, him and me.
Yes, and that is something I did raise in the history that I wrote when it was 100 years old. 150 years. Even, I know, I'm not numerate. I did raise this question of expanding its reach, as it were, and not a vast amount of progress has been made, I think, but you might like to touch on that a little bit, Bill.
Well, thank you. I'll just say, I think most of the important things have been already said by my two distinguished predecessors. I will say, as by way of introduction, that I'm the only person here, first of all, who was turned down twice by Andrew, of course. secondly, I'm the only one of the four here who didn't have a previous career. I was, Zanny came from the IMF, Rupert from the Bank of England, and Andrew from the Investors Chronicle. I also failed to get a job at the Investors Chronicle. Though I only discovered many years later, when I did a radio interview in Australia and got a telephone call to my hotel some way later by a journalist called Paul Barry, who had emigrated to Australia and had written a biography of Alan Bond and other things, and he called and said, do you remember an interview at the Investors Chronicle back in 1979? And I said, yes. He said, I was the person interviewing you. I'd just like you to know that I think we did make a mistake. and he told me the nice news that they shortlisted three people for this job, one of whom was me, the other was Will Hutton, and the third person who got the job, none of us could remember. So there we are. so that's a little puff. So I joined at the age of 24. I was doing a PhD on the French Communist Party at the time. Andrew went back to Bill Johnson and said, have you got any, bright but also cheap young people? Because I've got a need. And Bill Johnson, and I, of course, will love him forever, said, yes, I have. It's the same one as you rejected 2 years ago. And so Andrew kindly interviewed me again and hired me. He hired me to a job in Brussels, to a junior job in Brussels, which I took over from a name that you will remember, Chris Hune, who was leaving to join The Guardian. Of course, later went into politics and well, we better not go in further as to what happened later than that. But that was where it began. I was in Brussels, then I was in London working with Rupert, actually as an economics writer, with Rupert as economics editor. And then a job came up in Japan, which I had absolutely no qualifications for, but I noted that Andrew hadn't appointed anyone to it, and there obviously wasn't anyone who actually was qualified, so I put my hand up and said, well, what about some young whippersnapper? And to my great surprise and subsequent huge benefit and pleasure, Andrew took a risk on sending me out to Tokyo in 1983. So I had the formative experience of studying that country, of understanding the importance of it to our readers in the rest of the world, and trying to interpret the way in which that often baffling society and economy works. When I succeeded Rupert as editor in 1993, I'd say yes, to be honest, it certainly was on my plan to become editor. I'd always thought I wanted to. I think that one, to be honest, answer about why did you want to become editor, the answer is because I didn't want anyone else to screw it up. Because The Economist is such a precious place and such an important sort of organism that as you work for it for longer, you get more personal kind of ownership of it. And I think that the extra thing I would say about anonymity is that it produces a great sense of collective responsibility. It means you're willing to let the editor be a dictator, but also you care about what other people are writing. So that the staff, all of the journalists, I think, basically, they don't exactly police each other, but nevertheless, they actually care what the other people are doing and what the other people are thinking, what the other people are learning, and so forth, more than if they were Lone Ranger byline columnists doing their own thing. Because I think that it's part of a sense of kind of partnership that the anonymity of The Economist brings. What it also does is have a, you know, a slightly disconcerting effect on the editor, I think, sometimes, where, yes, it's fine, you can take credit for all the things that are wonderful that other people, that your brilliant team have done, and pretend that they were your idea in the first place. Well, we don't do that, but we one could. But also, you stand in the line of responsibility for things that people don't like in the paper, and I think that's a sort of important and sudden shock when you become editor. I was editor, I think, at the age of 36 or so. The biggest shock, apart from realizing that, as Andrew said, everyone in the paper knew far more than I did about everything, the second shock was being asked to lunch by the American ambassador at the time, and his second question was, what do you think about the future of NATO? And I realized I hadn't a clue what I thought about the future of NATO. But I better make something up quick. But in particular, I better learn quickly. And so that's the way it went. I will stop there.
Thank you. Well, Zanny, you're very new.
I haven't changed much, I hope, in the last 6 months.
What did you come into? How were you recruited?
How was I recruited? I was recruited by Bill, actually. Well, actually, he wasn't recruited by Bill. I approached Bill. I was at the IMF, as Bill said. I went to graduate school in the US. I then worked in Poland for a while as part of a cohort of interns with Jeff Sachs for the first post-communist government. And I then went to the IMF, which I enjoyed. I learned a lot, but I found somewhat like a military machine. And I decided that after a couple of years, I really wasn't cut out to be a bureaucrat. And that I thought, I had some good friends who were journalists and thought that they had a much more fun time than I did. And I sent a letter to Clive Crook, who was at that time economics editor, and said, can I come and see you? And Clive is a wonderful man, but not the world's most organized, so it took several attempts. But eventually we met up, and he said, I haven't got anything for you at all, but why don't you go and see Bill? And so I went to see Bill. And there began a series of conversations, a couple of test pieces. And I'm now, admired this even more than I did at the time, which was Bill did a fantastic negotiation, which enabled brought my salary down by, I think, about 85%. You did start off by saying, I can't match the IMF, but you were brilliant in getting me to accept that's virtually nothing. So I came over to London and spent a couple of years in London, and then for various reasons wanted to go back to America. And Bill was extremely accommodating and had, I think, separately thought it was time to create a new economics job in America. So I went back to America, where, for yet more complicated reasons, I stayed for the following 18 years, but in several different jobs, eventually being economics editor from America. And I came back to London only last year to be business affairs editor to run the back of the paper. So I've, in some sense, it's a sort of an interesting background because I've been on the paper a while, but I've spent very little time in London. So I have perhaps a somewhat different perspective than I might have if I had been in the Tower for the past 20 years. But I would second absolutely everything that all of you have said. It's really an extraordinary place with an extraordinarily powerful culture and unbelievably brilliant colleagues. Like all of you, I am surrounded by people far more brilliant than me, far better writers than me, who know collectively far more about everything than I do. And I think you said the words tapping the hoop, and I think that really is what this job is about. It's about adjudicating, tapping. I mean, leading is almost too pretentious a word, gently reaching conclusions. And I think probably the biggest responsibility is not just those judgments, but more importantly, ensuring that the next generation of economist writers is as brilliant as the current generation. And to your point, Ruth, I'd slightly take issue with your notion that everyone is still from Magdalen. There are now more Germans on the paper than Old Etonians. It's not...
One of them is here, half German.
It is not as broad... My colleagues are not from as broad a spectrum as one might want, but that is changing. And as the paper becomes, as we do more things online, as the culture of the place gently moves to the 21st century, so the nature of our staff is changing. And I think one of the challenges is going to be to continue that without losing what makes The Economist special. And that's something in lots of different areas where we're grappling with. I mean, for instance, we are a weekly newspaper in a 21st century world where a digital world, that's one shift that we're doing. We have processes and ways of producing the paper that essentially haven't changed in decades. You could come and do my job, and probably it would be not all that different in many ways to what you did. But some of that has to now be changed and updated, and we have, for example, introduced means of communication that are no longer just email. We have Slack, which is a medium for communicating. So those kinds of changes are the things that I think I and my colleagues are going to be dealing with perhaps more than the three of you had to.
Well, could I go back to Rupert for a moment? Because you talked about the oil horror you had. Rupert, what was your worst time?
Well, the worst mistake was that very soon after I became editor, I had a wonderful cover of a very benign-looking nuclear power station. And on the cover heading was The Charm of Nuclear Power, which had a sort of lyrical quality to it. And literally 3 weeks later, Chernobyl blew up in the Soviet Union, and with it the hopes and dreams of anyone who was in favor of nuclear power. And... one of my colleagues with a very delicate sense of humor who wrote the piece Inside, we had a cover which I covered myself in my embarrassment by putting the words in Russian script, Katastrofia, and the massive furnace, red, orange
covering the cover. But inside the reporting, someone had put at the title of their piece, "The Harm of Nuclear Power." And I thought, well, touche.
Okay.
That was the worst small episode. But I mean, you know, I was mighty blessed. Andrew refers to the coming collapse of communism. I was editor right through that period, and it was so easy almost every week to know what it is you were going to be writing about. It was right in the center of the Economist's sweet spot. I mean, we had been writing about the failures and the flaws and the nastiness of the communist system for decades, and how it was far inferior and far more inefficient, inequitable, and brutal than anything that Western capitalism could ever conjure up. And there, after all these years of advocacy and prediction, there it was coming true week after week after week. And that was bliss. It made it very, very easy. Almost every week, that was the cover. I mean, I probably exaggerate. When I look back, we probably had to manufacture covers and stories to hold a cover that could sustain a cover. But mostly, they were news covers. And mostly around that central theme. Very, very lucky.
Bill, can you talk a bit about Berlusconi?
Dear Silvio, well, this was that's kind of you to mention Berlusconi. I think I will just first say that perhaps our biggest, most embarrassing version of the charm of nuclear power in my time was actually the complete obverse of Andrew's and Norman McRae's Triumph on Oil, which was a cover that we ran in 1998, when oil was, believe it or not, $10 a barrel. And out of a conversation, actually with an oil executive, we started to think, well, what would there be consequences if oil fell even further, perhaps to $5 a barrel? And this became a cover called Drowning in Oil. It was $10 a barrel. Within, I think, 2 weeks, it had gone to 20. And then within 6 months, it had gone to 40. Why? Because OPEC had cutting production, reacting to the drowning. But anyway, we looked very wrong. And unfortunately invited Alex Salmond to lunch not long afterwards, and he teased us mercilessly about that as a former oil economist. Anyway, Berlusconi was a case in 2001 when we had been doing in The Economist a series of what you could call investigative stories. I never liked the term investigative journalism because I don't like the thought that any other sort of journalism exists. But nevertheless, there were sort of particularly forensic looks into corporate stories, in particular bad capitalists, if you like. We were blessed with having actually a former accountant who had who was writing for us and doing some of this research, who had the great important characteristic of a journalist who's trying to look at bad companies, which is that he typically understated the conclusions of everything he found. He wasn't an exaggerator that said 2 + 2 = 8. He was the one who said, well, look, 2 + 2 might equal just about 4, and this is what it tells you. So he had done a series of very compelling investigations into companies like the true profits of Virgin Atlantic, or the background to Formula One motor racing and ownership of it, and so forth. And people started to come up with suggestions for what he should do. And someone suggested we should look into this man, Silvio Berlusconi. And I confess, I wasn't entirely clear who Silvio Berlusconi was at the time. But I quickly found out he was coming up for his second tilt at the prime ministership in Italy. Owned all the commercial media in Italy except Sky. We did a long investigation into him. And what we realized, and what I realized, I think, as sort of the responsible person for not doing, but nevertheless guiding, as Annie accurately put it, was that this man symbolized some of the dangers of big business getting a grip on government. In other words, crossing the line between capitalism and democracy, and that therefore we should be even more, not aggressive, but even more, go even more hard on this issue than we otherwise would. And so we put him on the cover in the run-up just a few weeks before the 2001 Italian election, saying why Silvio Berlusconi is unfit to lead Italy, with a big three-page investigation. And because of the way Italy is, we basically were became suddenly famous in Italy. This was adopted by all of the left who hated Berlusconi. Berlusconi pointed out the obviously accurate fact that the motivation for this was that The Economist is a communist publication, and his newspaper, Il Giornale, proved this by putting a photograph of the then editor, me, on the cover, pointing out that I look like Lenin. So this began a beautiful friendship, really. He sued us twice. We carried on with further investigations. And made him into, I think, basically, why did we pursue the prime minister of a one European country? It was because he symbolized this issue, if you like, we could call it now the Trump issue, of businessmen, the danger of businessmen crossing the line, really, between capitalism and democracy. This has now led, in my case, to a book and a film. So I suppose I should say now I know quite a lot about Silvio Berlusconi, more than perhaps I want to, really.
Yes, Andrew wants to come in on communism.
Well, this is anecdotal, but we had a prime minister called Jim Callaghan during the disastrous late 70s. He was a very, very strong, good guy, actually, Labour, but he was overwhelmed by the forces, particularly trade unionism, at the time, which was militant around him. But anyway, the Gromyko, who was the foreign minister of Stalin, but certainly of Khrushchev and of Brezhnev, was in London on a visit. And there was a reception at Lancaster House, and I, along with the rest of Fleet Street and so on, was asked. And Callaghan, I happened to be near, and Callaghan had Gromyko there. Gromyko was one of these really dour, tough, probably intellectually brilliant, I would suspect, but ruthless communists who had come up through the party machine. And Callaghan said, oh, I can't remember whether he was Leonid or what he was, Gromyko, what was his name?
Andre.
Andre. Oh, Andre, this is Mr. Knight. He is from The Economist. Oh, you're a communist! Set me off on very good. I didn't contradict him.
Zanny, I mean, just talking about issues, commerce crossing the boundaries. I don't know what you'll be saying this week about Michael Ashcroft trying to buy the Tory party and being highly indignant that he had failed. But for you, who was away for so long, actually slotting into the collegiate aspect of it must have been tricky, was it? Or did you just instantly take to it?
Actually, there are many of my colleagues here who could probably answer this more honestly than I could. That didn't seem such. I mean, I had been in touch with the place a lot, even though I was in Washington. Certainly as economics editor, it was a job that is normally done from London, and so the fact that I was allowed to do it from Washington was... I, as a result, made quite a lot of effort to stay in touch with London, and there were various innovations made to enable me to do so, including the installation of a rather large microphone that hung down in the editor's office, which at that point was the time where all the editorial meetings were held. I've subsequently changed that, but at that time all the editorial meetings were in the editor's office, and I was told, rather like a sort of voice of God, you know, as I would hold forth. And I had an understanding with John Micklethwaite, who was the editor, that I wouldn't constantly butt in, which is, for those who know me, my tendency in the middle of a heated argument, but that I would wait to the end, and then I would say something. And I would keep the editorial meetings, which were on Monday, 11:15 in London, was 6:15 Washington time. So I would wander to get up rather earlier than that to read the newspapers, have my dressing gown on, sit downstairs in our sort of playroom stroke study, listen to this conversation, which went on for usually an hour and a half, with the telephone on mute, and listen to my colleagues discussing. And at one point, I had forgotten to put the telephone on mute, which I hadn't realized. And somebody was making an argument, and I said to myself, for God's sake, that's so stupid. And it was, or something along those lines. Do you remember, Daniel? There was some comment like that, which was then broadcast to the entire editorial meeting. But I did. It was through means like that that I stayed in touch with people. And so the coming back to the tower didn't feel like such a shock. What was, for me, interesting was coming back to London after being so far away. And I'm obviously British. I grew up here, but I haven't spent most of my adult life here. So I have, I think, a sort of perhaps a slightly different perspective on being in London and than I would have done if I'd been here for the whole of the last 20 years.
Most interesting. Andrew, good point.
Well, I think actually we're getting to the nub of something quite important here, which is the whole relationship between London as the centre of a small-ish or medium-sized country, and Washington and America, and America in its good clothes, namely as the sort of standard bearer of liberal democracy. We all know that America has many, many failings, which I think any free society is going to have. You pay a price for freedom, and there are some awful things happen in America. But basically, there's always been, in the modern Economist history, a relationship with America, not a servile relationship, very far from it, but a relationship because of where the Economist stands intellectually. And I think we need to remember that the Economist, it's collegiate, but it's not consensual. And it, necessarily, which is where the authority of an editor comes in very important moments. But one of its big functions is to be an intelligent and well-informed digest of so many issues around the world, and so many of those issues pass through Washington, even though they're not just the American ones, whether it's relations with China, or what's happening with China, Asia, anything. There's so much that goes through Washington. I was very lucky. I was only there for 2 and a bit years. I wanted to be there far, far longer, but Alistair, my editor, dragged me back to my fury, because I love being in Washington, and it's very important, and I think actually this is something which Ruth, I think, will have noticed and did notice in her book, which is that if you are working for The Economist, even though you're anonymous and nobody knows your name, you have a phenomenal advantage in America in two ways. First of all, they all rather soft-heartedly, I just love your accent, and they love the fact that you're a sort of young, apparently, because you're young and not American, attractive writer for The Economist. But far more important structurally is that all the rest of the European journalists there are up against a 5 and 6 and 7 and 8 hour time disadvantage. They're having to file on, let us say in my time, Bobby Kennedy's death, which I was involved in at the time, because I knew him and had been talking to him on the telephone a few minutes before he died. They were all having to scurry and write, whereas you are actually in The Economist, because you're weekly, and because you've got time to get around, you're not up against the deadline all the time, you do find out a hell of a lot, and you become really seriously well-informed. If you're doing your job, you become seriously, seriously well-informed on an awful lot of things, which the guys on the FT and so on find far, and the Times and Le Monde and Neue Zürcher Zeitung and so on, they find it far harder because they're on this daily grind of reporting from the most important capital in the world, Washington, or from New York, the most important or one of the most important business centers in the world, and they're having to do it up against a deadline. And they're having to do it against a deadline which is 5 hours ahead, or Los Angeles, 8 hours. And whereas The Economist guy is flitting around, getting to know everybody, he's got time to go out to dinner with people who matter. In my time, I became intimate not with the president, but certainly with Kissinger and all those people, I knew that they were real people that I really knew. And in a way that the other correspondents just didn't. So you become amazingly well-informed wherever you were. And afterwards, I was in Brussels, and I had, without the time disadvantage, I had exactly the same experience. I think we've all experienced that. We've all experienced working for The Economist. I don't know how it was in Tokyo, where the time disadvantage would have been completely different. But it meant that we were amazingly well-informed and by journalistic standards. And that, therefore, what you get in The Economist is, I remember a very close associate of three of us on the table, Dudley Fishburne. He always used to say that, or would say today, he's very much alive and kicking, he always used to say the key, there have been lots of people in America who've tried to set up competitors to The Economist. And he always used to say, and does say, I'm sure, that the point about The Economist is that it is a global newspaper, pause, produced in London. And that's what gives it its extraordinary ability, provided it does a good job, to go on and across a very, very wide spectrum. So I think that Washington or American experience is absolutely vital. I don't mean you have had to have worked there, because several of us haven't, Zanny and I haven't to have done. But it is terribly, terribly important, because that, it's an astonishing, what is the circulation of The Economist in America now?
Just under 850,000.
Right, the circulation of The Economist in America today is 850,000.
Give or take.
When I became editor, it was, anybody get, somebody guess, 28,000 copies. And thanks to the chairman at the time, Evelyn de Rothschild, me also, I have to say, but and one non-executive director, John Sainsbury, the three of us forced through the board, literally, by not force of numbers, the whole notion that we would spend money to get into America. And by the time I left, I think it was 150,000. But it has a resonance, The Economist, because, as Dudley Fishburne said, it is an intelligent digest of every issue you can possibly imagine, not just what's in the leaders, what we've been talking about. You know, we took a line on this, we took a line on that, the fall of the wall, all those big issues, but on every conceivable political issue of political economy that you can imagine, all the way across the board. You've got a little team of people who are amazingly well informed. I should just add one thing, I think, which is that the anonymity issue, Rupert referred to it, gives the editor enormous power, because but it also actually promotes the careers of an awful lot of people who work at The Economist, because some of them cannot write for Toffee. But they get jobs elsewhere because they've been rewritten by the four of us.
Zanny had her hand.
Can I just add two perspectives there? Because I think you raised lots of very interesting points, Andrew, and I completely agree that, you know, our success in the US has been one of the most sort of striking developments of The Economist over the past decades. I think it's in part because of the global perspective. I also think it's in part because of our independence. In fact, very powerfully because of our independence. We are, unlike most of the US media, we are seen not as being in a partisan corner, but as being genuinely independent, and we have, you know, our free market views align more with those on the center-right, our social liberalism more with those in the Democratic Party, so we don't fall into the easy categorization that is much more common on that side of the Atlantic. I think also, and perhaps this is where I would go further and have a slightly different perspective than you, I think we do need to be an intelligent digest of what's happened over the past week, but I don't think that's enough. I think that is no longer sufficient for The Economist. I think we, in addition to that, have to be the place where people read, and this is a phrase I use constantly with my colleagues, but mind-stretching ideas that they have not read anywhere else before. We have to be a guide to the future. We have to interpret the world and show people where it is going, all the time imbued with the liberalism which is at our core. And I think that's, for me, the absolute most important is that we are loyal to that 19th century liberalism, but we reinterpret it to deal with 21st century challenges. And that sounds slightly pretentious. It's not meant to be. It means simply that we don't repeat old mantras, but that we constantly assess today's problems with the values that we have held for the last 173 years. And so if I look at what I've been trying to do, and it's very, very early days, but and I've been blessed or troubled, depending on your perspective, perhaps with not quite such a... I mean, there's a lot going on in the world, but a lot of what I've put on the cover, for example, have been issues and subjects that I think are really important that people need to know about. Artificial intelligence, gene editing, lots of technological developments that I think are hugely important, that we think are hugely important, where we are sort of window into the future as much as a champion of ideas. And then I've also, and this is, I know, an area that is controversial, but I think we should champion causes. We should not be lobbyists, but we should champion causes through the force of argument. We were founded to do that, and I think you championed many. Gay marriage, notably, you put on the cover in 1996, and in a small way, we are doing the same with The Right to Die, which is I put on the cover the end of June, a controversial issue, but one that I think we care about enormously. So I think all of those things, in addition to being the intelligent digest of the week's news.
This is all very, very interesting, Bill. Yes, Rupert, after that, will you talk about independence?
I'm going to steal a bit of Rupert's thunder on independence, but I'm also going to say, since Zanny's been nice to me, Rupert championed legalization of drugs 30 years before it became common currency. And that's been something that's continued through the paper. I just wanted to add, in a way, we must avoid being a kind of self-congratulatory set of close to what Prince Charles said of the Chinese Politburo, a bunch of Madame Tussauds waxworks. So you better interrupt us and tell us how bad we are. But I just want to, one little extra point about access and so on, which I wanted to add to Andrew's. A key characteristic of The Economist, which helps make it what it is that while we have brilliant access all around the world because of the reputation of the paper that has been built up over the generations and its wide readership, we are not part of any national establishment. And a sort of key question about The Economist has always been, are you a member of the establishment? And the answer, to be honest, is of course, well, we are. You know, we can't pretend we're not part of some sort of elite, but we are not actually in the loop, as it were, as media often are, in Washington, nor in London, nor in Paris, nor in Tokyo. We are sort of slightly outside every loop, which is a great advantage. It means you're not vulnerable to the phone call constantly coming in from number 10 Downing Street. You're not vulnerable to pressure from the White House in the way that I think other publications are. In my 13 years as editor, I got a protest from 10 Downing Street only once. Of course, when the protest came, it confirmed exactly that we were right. But nevertheless, we're not part of that sort of pressure group that comes in the establishment. So we have access, but independence is the vital thing that we have that makes it easier to be editor, I'd say. So over to you, Rupert.
Yeah, I think independence is something which we can trumpet to the outside world and have some recognition and some appreciation from our readers. But to my mind, it really is most important that it exists in the minds of our journalists, that they know that they are coming in on a Monday morning with the opportunity to write about anything they want, subject only to the disciplines of their own colleagues and ultimately to the approval or otherwise of the editor, and that there is no other agenda than they choosing what they think is really interesting and important and deserves to be read by our readers. And that is a huge
DNA advantage that very few other journalists, I think, ever experience. And all our journalists experience that all the time. And some of them probably don't really appreciate or recognize it. And in a way, that's fine. I never minded that. And then you, as the editor, are the gatekeeper. And you do get the calls. You do get the calls from the infuriated banker and from the very angry press officer from number 10 Downing Street and occasionally from a very angry chancellor. You do get those calls and you field them. And that is a big part of your job. And actually, rather a shock when you are 36 as I was, or no, what was I, 38, you were 36. Anyway, we were all far too young.
You looked 36.
You know, that is quite a shock, that you are having to bat away people who are very, very busy, but have taken the time to vent their spleen against something that's been written in the paper. And you have to say, well, I'm terribly sorry, but we hear what you say, and we disagree with you. And none of that should ever filter it back to any of your colleagues. You should be there on behalf of them. The importance of our constitution, the way the company is structured, the ownership, the rights and responsibilities of different groups of shareholders, is something that has been very carefully designed to protect the independence of the editor. Trustees who are there, who are an entirely self-appointed group, who have only one job, which is there to be the guardian of the editor's independence. And they do that by approving the appointment, and if there was ever any suggestion that the board wanted to get rid of the editor, it would be the trustees who would have the ultimate decision. So they are there, again, part of the constitutional arrangements. And these are very important, and I think they've given all four of us, and John, the absent one, they've given all five of us an enormous sense of security and comfort, knowing that they are there, and knowing that as a result, actually, the issue will never arise. You knew as editor that you were running an independent publication, and that then permeated the culture and the atmosphere of everything we did.
Can I give three examples? Can I just give three very tangible examples of that? There's three forms of independence. One is from the commercial pressures inside your own organization. The other is from the board, which many a newspaper editor and journalist experiences. And the third is from the political world. I had only one issue where I really profoundly disagreed with the commercial leadership of inside the paper. I went to the chairman of the trustees, then an extraordinary man called Lord Franks, and the management was warned off. That was it. Over. Done. It never arose again. Secondly, a little bit before that, most of you will obviously have heard of the House of Rothschild, you know, the great bankers of the 19th and 20th century. The Rothschild Bank in London had a huge row and split in, I forget when, but 1982 or 3, where two cousins, Evelyn de Rothschild and Jacob Rothschild, had a very public row, and it dominated the business pages of of all the newspapers for several weeks in London. Now, Evelyn de Rothschild, one of the two disputants in this row, was chairman of The Economist at the time. We actually took the side of Jacob Rothschild, his cousin, i.e. against the interests of our own chairman. Our chairman
Evelyn de Rothschild, used to come into The Economist quite regularly, sometimes two or three times a month, and he'd always blow through my office and make sure I was all right. He never once mentioned it. Never once. Even though we, the paper of which he was chairman and a very significant shareholder, even though we'd taken the side of his cousin against him, he never mentioned it to me once. And I felt completely free to do that. A third one argues against, or doesn't argue it against, but is from government. When Mrs. Thatcher became Prime Minister, her Tory predecessor, 7-8 years before, had been destroyed by the miners' unions, who were very militant and were against closure of pits. We needn't go into the issue itself, and you all know you can have different points of view on that. When Mrs. Thatcher came in, the miners struck in about 81 or so, 80, 81, I forget when precisely. We took a very strong line, which was, you know, the miners' union led by Arthur Scargill are wrong, the government must stand up to them, and so on and so forth. The government caved in, and we attacked the government. We said, you know, this is wrong, what a terrible lost opportunity, they should have stood up to the miners. The Minister for Energy at the time, who later became Chancellor of the Exchequer and is the father of two very famous children, Nigel Lawson, was Minister of Energy. He called me, I didn't know him very well, he's a very brilliant mind, he'd been editor of The Spectator in his time. He called me and said, would I go and see him? And I thought, ha, here we go. He's going to try and bring influence to bear on me, and I'm going to stand up to him and support our team, Rupert said. I went along to see him. He's a very numerate man, and he put in front of me some very simple figures, which were the size of the coal stocks in power stations around the UK. And the coal stocks were extremely low. He said, Andrew, if we'd done what you recommended, we would have lost an industrial strike because the coal stocks were so low we couldn't have kept the power stations going. You just watch what we do. And I went back and I realized that we had got it completely wrong. The government was in no position whatever to fight a strike against the coal miners. And sure enough, single-mindedly, over the next two or three years, the coal stocks of the power stations were built up. Up and up and up, so that by the time the famous miners' strike took place in 84, 85, there were enough coal stocks there and the government won, and it was a historic event. Right or wrong, whatever you feel, it was an historic event in English, British industrial history, which then led on to the Wapping dispute, which was another historical event, and a complete change in the balance of power between trade unions and business and government. And so that Nigel Lawson, an analytical, interesting politician, had got it right, and we had got it completely wrong. I only say that I felt entirely independent when I went in to see him, because I thought I was going to be standing up for our paper's line, we'd taken the good free market line, the trade unions were wrong, and he demonstrated to me that we were wrong, and I was able to come back and ask a person who was writing about it to go and see somebody in the Ministry of Energy because the numbers were rather interesting. But those are three, I'm just trying to give you tangible examples of what this phrase independence means. It means that you can take a stand, whether it's against your own commercial people inside the paper, or whether it's against the board, in this case, the chairman of the board, who absolutely hands off. I should admit that about 3 months later, his wife attacked me at a cocktail party, but that's all. And thirdly, vis-a-vis government. You don't often get called in, but you get called in, and then all you have to do is listen and then stand up for your people, unless you reckon that you're wrong. But it's a very interesting situation to be in. Now, I think the editor of the Times, the editor of the FT, they would all be in those positions, but they wouldn't be quite as free as Zanny Minton Beddoes is now.
And I would like here, if that's so interesting, all of it, just to take the independence point a bit further. Rupert, can you tell us about the ownership? Because something very dramatic has happened.
Well, we've had a...
Which you deserve a lot of credit.
Yeah, a big change in the ownership, in the sense that the Financial Times owned 50% of the shares in The Economist, and all the designated B shares. There are A shares and B shares, which are small in number but have the right to appoint directors to the board. And they had been in various guises, initially as the Financial News and then subsequently coming through into today's Financial Times. They had been our big shareholder for many years. But for 30 years, there had always been some uncertainty about how durable that ownership of that 50% would be. And sure enough, at some point, it was going to change, and it happened in July this year, when we were told that the Pearson, the owner of the FT, had decided to sell the Financial Times, but partly prompted by our requests, had agreed to take the 50% shareholding in The Economist out of the sale of the Financial Times to the Nikkei Japanese media group. We then had a wonderful opportunity to secure those 50% for many more decades to come in a form that would respect the independence of the group and of The Economist. We had on our board already a director called John Elkann, an Italian who, through a holding company which largely represents his own family's holdings, owned 5% of The Economist. And he was keen to increase his stake, which he bid a price that the Pearson owners were happy with, and a higher price for all the B shares, which would give him the right to appoint directors to the board. And then we, the company, decided to buy back the remaining ordinary shares and, as it were, neutralize them. In order to afford to be able to do that, we are having to sell our building, which Zanny will be able to tell you is not actually, in terms of our current needs and our needs for the future, I think a great disaster. The wonderful thing was we were able to use a very cherished part of our overall assets to secure something even more cherished, which is the independence of the group. And we have just literally 2 days ago passed all the resolutions among the shareholders to make that happen. And later this year, it will be the deal will be finalized and the money will change hands and so on. So we have, I think, put ourselves in a very strong position, new security for decades to come. And that's a very happy outcome for us.
You've really come in at quite a remarkable time, Zanny, because you've got, you're going to lose the building, you've got the whole ownership, not panic, it's been terribly well handled, obviously, but you've also got the EU possibly tottering and the whole migration business. I mean, they're massive, massive, massive issues. Could be changing our entire world.
They are. It's an interesting world. Let me take them two separately, because you're right, both in terms of the Economist's own future and in terms of the sort of challenges facing the world we live in. I would submit that I live in at least as interesting times as my predecessors. But I'm more upbeat, actually, on both of them than your question suggests. On The Economist, I don't think see it as losing the building. I think this ownership shift has, as Rupert said, it is the second really dramatic change in our ownership structure in our history, but it's extraordinarily positive. The editors and the editorial independence of the paper has been long very well guarded and secured, but we have now reinforced the commercial independence of the paper. which I think is an enormous step forward. It is time for us as a 21st century media organization to be in a different building. The Tower is a wonderful, iconic building on St. James's Street, but if you actually go inside it rather than admire it from the outside, it is not the most appropriate premises.
I'm sorry, could I just interrupt? I wouldn't want you to think I liked that building.
You know, well, I don't
know that just as much as it is to not.
I don't know that, but I think that we are, as you know, we are in the midst of a huge disruption in our industry, and we've had the luxury for the last 173 years of essentially doing the same thing, of producing a really outstanding weekly newspaper, and then our colleagues on the commercial side sold it and persuaded large numbers of people to be subscribers and persuaded large numbers of companies to advertise in it, and that was a recipe that worked extraordinarily well, and under my three predecessors, circulation soared. The world is now changing really quite very dramatically, and our industry is changing very dramatically. And I happen to think that we are extraordinarily well placed to prosper in that industry, in that change, because the kind of really outstanding journalism that my colleagues do is one that I think has a very strong future in this disrupted media landscape. I think there are many, many millions of potential Economist subscribers out there, and thanks to digital technology, we can reach them much more easily than we used to. But people's reading habits are changing. The digital revolution, particularly the mobile revolution, means that we are having to change with the times, and not only having to, we should be at the forefront. We're a newspaper that looks to the future. We should be, and we are, embracing that future. So I think it's an extraordinarily exciting time, and I think actually the move in location when it comes is sort of in some sense symbolic of that shift. So I'm very excited about that. In terms of the world we're in, you're right, it's interesting times. There, I think, in many ways, the liberalism that we stand for is under threat or under challenge, under intellectual challenge, in a way that it hasn't been, I would submit, in my three predecessors present here's tenure. In some sense, the world was going in the direction of what the Economist stood for, really starting, Andrew, sort of beginning to during your editorship, intellectual at least, although in policy terms it wasn't, but then certainly in the 80s and the 90s and the 2000s. And I think now that liberal global consensus is under some strain. And it is under some strain. We see it in the migrant crisis. We see it in the growth of populist politics, whether it's Donald Trump or whether it's Marine Le Pen. And we see very serious challenges, whether it is
Volkswagen. New.
Sorry?
See it in Volkswagen.
You see it in Volkswagen. You see it in. And you have, you know, genuinely set against the backdrop of the extraordinary increase in people's well-being that you described, Andrew, and I think is absolutely right, over the past few decades. You do have a great increase in income disparities, you have a stagnation of wages or incomes towards the lower end of the skill level in rich countries, you have the challenge of climate change, you have lots of big challenges and people, growing numbers of people, feeling disenchanted with the status quo. And I think it's incumbent on us to champion liberal values, But to really look at today's problems through that prism and to come up with, you know, an analysis and policy suggestions that are appropriate for the times. And one, this was, when did I write this? Three years ago. I wrote a special report on inequality called True Progressivism, which was an attempt to explain why widening income disparities were actually not good for growth and not a terribly good idea, and why there were the right ways, or to argue the right ways to think about narrowing them. And I think that's exactly the kind of agenda that we should be looking at, and that we should be coming at today's problems with our liberal values and liberal perspective, but really addressing them. And we've got a lot to do there, a lot to do. And I think to sort of be a standard bearer for the the values that we have, but for the virtues of an integrated world, a world where trade is free, where capital moves freely, where people move freely. That is increasingly going to be a world under challenge, and I think we need to defend it, but we can't defend it by using old tropes. We need to defend it by constantly making the argument and making the argument based on the best evidence in the light of current circumstances. So, for example, you know, the refugee crisis I've put twice on the cover. I shall continue to that we keep pushing on that, and we keep it, it's these are really, really huge questions that will define the nature of Europe, as you put it, but the nature of the kind of globalization that we have in future. And so I think that's this is a sort of a battle makes it sound too negative, but I think it's a set of challenges that are not going to go away, and we can't take the world that we've seen in the last few decades for granted.
Right, now, I gather we've got another 15 minutes, as I'm writing. Yes. If anybody would like to ask a question, we're not going to run out of things to talk about here, I can assure you, but just in case anybody's burning to ask a question. Yes.
Daniel Frank, and I was an economist for 32 years past. Yes. Eternally grateful always to Andrew for hiring me. Before I ask my question, I just wanted to say thank you to Tiago for organising an event on the 175th anniversary of The Economist, and unlike journalists, you're ahead of deadline, so that's a very happy thing. 2018. One of the themes that emerges very strongly from what all of you said is continuity. But I think it's also interesting to think of change within the paper. The paper that I joined under Andrew was Black and White. It divided the world into a Britain section, then called the American Survey. We had a Europe section, and everything else was under international. And then we gradually introduced Asia section, Americas, Middle East and Africa, China section more recently. The paper acquired colour, it acquired things like essays, and of course it's gone digital. You can get it in on your app, online, and it also has moved into daily journalism, something called Espresso, I'm sure that you look at every morning. So my question to each of you is, despite continuity, which I think has been the underlying theme, there's been all this change. What's the biggest innovation of your time as editor?
Undoubtedly the biggest innovation in my time. Well, there's one innovation which I'm furious about because I didn't think of it, and the others, and it happened after me, and that is the obituaries. The obituary on the back page, I wish I'd thought of that, and it's absolutely fantastic. No, the biggest innovation in my time, I suppose, well, there are quite a few, but the biggest one was the science technology section. And that happened, but a wonderful, wonderful man, whom we all except Zanny knew, called Richard Casement, who was an obsessive, typical economist person, obsessive about transport. He wanted to pave over all the railways and make them into dual carriageways for cars. And he went on and on and on about this, and it was very difficult to keep him from proposing at every editorial conference that he got to that subject. So I said, well, look, Richard, why don't you go and do something new? And I sent him off to America, and he went to visit Intel, a chip-making company, which none of us, it's hard for all of you to realize, you know, computers, the only computers that existed then were as big as this room, literally. And this has more capacity on it than the whole of the computer in this room. So he came back with a photograph, I don't know whether he'd taken it, of a microchip on somebody's index finger. So here was this little microchip sitting on a finger where you could actually see the grains of the finger like that. And he came into my office and he said, Andrew, you've seen that? I said, well, what's that? He said, that is going to be running our world. It's going to be running everything. You're going to be walking around with computers in your pocket. Everything is going to change. And it was so exciting that I got him to write, I didn't have to get him, he was pushing it on me, a two or three page piece which just had only one photograph, which was a huge blown-up thing where you could actually see the grains of a guy's finger with this microchip on it. And out of that came, it was totally his idea. Everybody else opposed it, including me to begin with, because it meant finding space from other sections, this science and technology section. And of course, through him, he then died of a heart attack, very, very young. His successor, Alice Barris, died of cancer a few weeks later, and not weeks, months later. And then 23, 20, by then he was 25-year-old, contemporary of all of ours, Matthew Ridley, who you will now read, some of you, in the Times, but he's now in the House of Lords. He's a very, very brilliant man. He, aged 25, took on the Times, the science and technology section, and it was already motoring, but he made it even better. And so that's the major, because obviously it's both in computer technology, but also in medical technology and many other technologies, that's something. Now, that's something which none of us, in those days we were so narrow, none of us had even dreamt of it being important. It was an extraordinary thought, that. But it was, and it was Richard, and I wish he was here to hear what I'm saying, because, I mean, he just was a total pioneer. But then so much else has happened, as you know, all these sections that you mentioned, Daniel, which we were very strict, you see, at the time. The commercial battle that I had, which was when they were trying to load on us more advertising, and that we must keep the editorial pages down, and we must carry more advertising as a ratio. That was the one that, so to speak, the management was warned off on. But even so, we had a sort of self-denying ordinance that we mustn't expand the paper beyond 60 or 65 editorial pages. That has gone out of the window, and quite rightly, because of the Asia section and all the other sections that have been added. At the time, our whole mindset was not to do that.
Thank you.
I liked reading columns in other papers, and we didn't have anything like that. And so my best innovation was to introduce first in the Britain section a politics page, and because of the anonymity we decided to give it some sort of identity and character and gave it the name Badgett, who was our greatest editor from the 19th century. And then a year or two later in the American Survey section, which a page which is called Lexington, which is where the first shots were fired in the War of Independence between Britain and America. Subsequently, that has become a feature right across the paper, whole page things, and I think that was very helpful way and very attractive for journalists who have that outlet. My biggest mistake was to think I could extend that to sport, which happens to be a particular passion of mine. And I left, and my successor rather cruelly killed it within days, and then replaced it with the obituaries, which were far, far more successful and far better, frankly.
And that's you, Bill.
It's true, I did replace the fittest people in the world with the deadest. It's true. and the commercial people, by the way, on the obituary, the commercial side of the company were aghast at the thought that that I was going to introduce an obituary page. They, particularly when I think I used a rather maladroit form of persuasion, where I said that I thought that it would make the paper more human. They said, "You want to write about dead humans and expect us to sell the page opposite it." Anyway, it has been very popular. Basically the answer is that a concept that was familiar to me when I was in Japan, which of Kaizen, of continuous improvement, really has been what's characterized working at The Economist. I mean, a sort of constant adaptation to the changing circumstances of the times within which each of us have steered the ship. And I think in my time, the biggest sort of continuous improvement aspect was quite a substantial expansion of our overseas offices, of the sort of the proportion of the paper that was being written by staff correspondents in overseas offices. Why? Because of globalization and particularly the increase in interest in emerging economies. So we opened an office in Beijing and so on and so forth. I think that's probably the most important change. Color did come in during my time. It was an inevitable and important part of the continuous improvement of the paper that was just held up by technology, but I think has helped to make the paper more easily readable. But it is essentially a continuous process of improvement.
Well, if I could just add one thing, which is that for those of us who are sports junkies like Rupert and myself, we always, with our daily newspaper reading, go to the back page first. I always read the back pages first because they're the sports pages. Now I can do it on The Economist. I go to the obituary. Yes. It's in the back page. It's actually fantastic. It's just made such a difference.
Well, as you say, it's early days. So what have I changed? The first change I made was to get rid of Sir on the letters page. I assume that may be a temporary change, but that's gone. Since then, a few evolutionary innovations rather than revolutionary, which have actually built on what you have been saying. Your science and technology section is now longer than it ever was, and I'd like to shift the focus to be as much on technology as it is on science. I think that that's, given the world we're in, an enormously important part of the paper, and as I said, we've probably done relatively more than had been done in the recent past on where technology is going. The biggest change, actually, the biggest new innovation in the last 6 months is one that, Daniel, you yourself suggested, edited, and pioneered, which was the supplement in the summer called The World If, which was a look at scenarios, which would what would happen if. And it was 10 pages, and I think was a great success, and we will certainly repeat it. And I think will become, I hope, a sort of an annual addition to The Economist. There are other things in the works, so you'll watch this space in terms of changes within the paper, but they will be evolutionary. We are also in the midst of a fairly comprehensive update, redesign, revamp of our website, of our apps, and indeed of the paper's design. So that will all become evident in due course. But I think that's actually, particularly on the digital side, where we have the most work to do. When we first introduced our app and indeed created our website a few years ago, it was pretty cutting edge. It's not really at all anymore. So that's where we've got a lot to do.
And getting rid of the must or should mindset.
Yes, I mean, there are some, you know, must or should are a sort of lazy way. I think you're absolutely right. It is far better to lay out an appropriate course of action by the power of one's argument than by exhortation. And so certainly we shouldn't do that. There will also be, I think, fewer leaders restating our line on obvious things, because I think that it's important to engage with the debate of today. I use this, it's not an elegant term, but I couldn't think of a better one when I use the word mind stretching. I think we need to really engage and stretch readers' minds and have and our own minds and really push boundaries, whether they're sort of intellectual, conceptual boundaries, whether it's just looking to the future. That's where we can add the most, and it's also sort of, I think, which is what is at our core. That's what we've been doing for 173 years. And if we look, it's tempting, and it's particularly tempting to be too self-congratulatory and to look backwards. And I think that would be we should rightly be very proud of where we've come from and what we've achieved, and we're all. And I'm very aware that I am the kind of, you know, just the current person who this extraordinary heritage is entrusted to. But we're not about looking backwards. The Economist has never really been about looking backwards. We're about looking forwards. And so that's very firmly where I think we should continue to be focused.
I think if I could just add to that, the only crucial thing I'd add to that is that the thing that all of us, I think, we're always aware of is that none of our readers has to read The Economist. Yep. They may have to read The Wall Street Journal. They may have to read some major publication in their country. None of them has to read The Economist. Our task is to make them want to read The Economist.
And could I just add, as a disgruntled historian, that so much were they not wedded to the past that they threw out all their papers merrily every week, and it was absolute hell trying to find anything to read the history of The Economist on. Sorry, did one of you want to add something? The gentleman behind Daniel Franklin.
Oh.
And then there was somebody over there.
Hi, Steve Schimper is a minor dean professor of financial journalism at Citi and former economist, economic reporter at BBC News. I just wondered the reaction of the other editors to Zanny's point that globalization, perhaps in its various formats, is now under threat, as it hasn't been perhaps in the period that they were editing, and what their view of what the changes are and what the liberal response should be to that. And perhaps also Zanny, in terms of geopolitical shifts. I mean, a number of you really started your career and had an important experience in America and see America as the route through which globalization perhaps was developed. Just wonder how you want the future to reflect perhaps a geopolitical shift towards China as at least the major, perhaps dominant economic power in the century, and how that will affect both your coverage and your stance.
That should keep you occupied.
How long have we got?
Yes, quite.
I'd like to just take issue. The only thing I would take issue with Zanny is that, and it would come to subjects like that. I can remember, you know, the three of us have been talking about a genius that we worked with called Norman McRae. He was, because he cared so much about intellectual thrust, he would get frightfully upset when he heard us all following the conventional wisdom. And I can remember several occasions when we would have an editorial conference and everybody would be saying, oh, no, we've written about that already. We've written about that already. And I knew what would happen. The editorial conference would disperse and he'd come back into my office and he'd say to Andrew, it's only when you've written about it the sixth or seventh time that anybody's going to notice.
That's fair. Absolutely right.
So, yeah. That's right. You know, I think repetition actually bears, on the verities, repetition bears it, bears doing.
I think I might just answer briefly Steve's question. I think that ever since The Economist was founded in 1843, globalization has always been under challenge. Free trade is actually a remarkably difficult concept to persuade people of the merits of, despite the fact that it seems obvious to us. And at the reason The Economist has had its life so over such a long period is because of that constant argumentation and the need to persuade on this. I do think it's under particular stress now, but actually I think in all our times it was under stress. I remember carrying covers about the anti-WTO riots in Seattle and so forth. I think you wrote that. Yes, exactly. There you are. There you are. Very good, too. I remember writing a pro-free trade leader for Rupert when he was editor. So I think it's a constant issue. And I don't think we should ever think that we just simply need to say, I refer the honourable member to our answer to the previous question, as it were, because one constantly has to deal with new arguments, new challenges, and persuade in new ways.
That's exactly the point that I was trying to make. That one has to, and you're right. The verities bear repetition, but continually making the argument in a way that is relevant to the challenge of the time is what we need to try and do. I think you raise a really interesting question about China at a very sort of simple level. We've obviously introduced the China section, and I would imagine that over the course of the next few years, that section will become larger and or more prominent. The question of the relative position of the US versus China and the geopolitical and economic consequences, both the sort of international monetary consequences and the consequences for the sort of Pax Americana in the Pacific, I think are going to be very, very important questions for us to consider and to, you know, have a view on over the coming years. I think we won't shift, our perspective won't shift. It'll still be us continue to interpret our liberalism. That will, I think, put us naturally on one side of that rather than the other, but I think taking, sort of going through what the consequences of that shift are, and actually we have coming up a very interesting long essay on the nature of American economic power in the 21st century, which is exactly tackling that kind of question.
Did you want to add anything, Rupert?
Well, only that I wouldn't be at all surprised if the big story of the next 30 years is the decay of the Communist Party system in China,
yep,
and its gradual replacement by something which will not necessarily be a model of Westminster democracy, but it will change. I think that system is under huge strain itself.
Yes, you only have to see the protest and the way people are having to move on pollution, aerial, notably atmospheric pollution in some of the big cities in China. I mean, that can't be controlled from top down. It's being controlled effectively by popular pressure from beneath.
I can't resist pointing out that one of the dictums of Deng Xiaoping, very similar to one of the dictums of James Wilson, our founder at The Economist, Deng Xiaoping said, seek truth from facts. I think it was him or Mao. And in the original edition in 1843, we will seek to lay out the facts and draw the conclusions from them, or some phrase like that. We seek truth from facts.
You need to wind up in a minute, but there's a desperate man there. I hope it's quick.
Mark Potter and LLC, thank you for your comments. As you're navel gazing, I'm wondering if you can entertain this sort of marketplace of ideas. You can comment on how do you define the boundary between which ideas crowd out the debate and which ones actually widen and enhance the discourse. Because recently, not only in the current issue, but in other ones, there have been quite sort of packed, explicit, normative statements about various ideas are not necessary, or they're not right, or they're in fact, in many ways, antithetical to the debate. Without the kind of rigorous analysis that's expected to shut down the debate before it even happens. So I'm curious to know, if you're coming from this sort of, and a lot of students bring this up too, especially graduate students, and other observations, if you're coming from a presumption that the economistic Anglo-American position is the privileged one, how do you guard against inhibiting healthy debate and the notion that you can sort of read the tea leaves and say this doesn't belong in the marketplace of ideas before it even happens?
Well, I think Zanny, this
is... I would take issue with your premise. I don't think anything should be excluded from the marketplace of ideas. What I would hope we would do would be to look at an idea, to explain why we think it is not a good idea, and through the rigor of our analysis and explanation, to show that it's not a good idea. I'm not quite sure what you're referring to. I suspect it may be our coverage of Corbyn.
There have been other ones as well, too, but I'm wondering, from the position that you take, how do you guard against sort of or preempting the kind of discussions that could happen when, in fact, they still haven't really developed?
In what we've written, I certainly wouldn't preempt any discussions happening. I think we should be absolutely a place that takes all ideas and explains why we do think they're good ones or why we don't think they're good ones. If you were present at any of our editorial meetings, you would find that all manner of ideas are discussed and all manner of views are put forward, and there's certainly no sense of any of my colleagues that anything is excluded from the marketplace of ideas. And there is a very vigorous debate, and a vigorous debate in which I hope, and I'm sure we fall short on occasion, but in which I hope the most convincing, well-argued idea or argument wins the day, holds the day.
I would just only add that I think a role of the editor is to make sure that that debate happens. That the biggest danger of something like The Economist is groupthink,
is
people in the room thinking, I wonder what Zanny wants me to say, and therefore saying it, rather than coming up with the subversive idea. Our job is partly to make sure that that doesn't happen, to do what Andrew did with Norman and say, yes, let's not follow the conventional wisdom, to encourage, and actually my deputy editor, Clive Crook, often used to say, I think quite rightly, the most important test for my liberal ideas is the apparent contradiction to them. So the successful nationalized industry, for one or whatever, that's where we need to scrutinize, not self-satisfyingly kind of say our ideas are wonderful.
If I just give a little example of where I would, so to speak, argue with you, as opposed to in favor of what you're saying, which is that if there was a celebrated, notorious thing where the Economist was absolutely last in the trench defending the Vietnam War. It was a huge subject at the time. The Economist just argued in favor of LBJ, in favor of the of intervention there, and so on, right till the dying day. And I always remember I was a middle-ranking junior person on The Economist at the time, and I was visiting from Brussels, where I was working. A man called Adam Yarmolinsky, who was one of the great intellectuals of the Kennedy era, had returned to Harvard, and he was one of, if not the, leading intellectual in America against the Vietnam War. And he came to lunch, off and on, and he was there, and I was there on one occasion. And Alistair, the then editor, said to Adam, but Adam, why do you still come to lunch with us when we represent everything that you don't agree with? You are the leader of the intellectual argument against the Vietnam War, and here are we, the leading exponent and proponent of intervention in Vietnam. And Adam said, I come here because I want to test my opinions. I come here because I know, and I read The Economist every week, because I want to test why it is that I'm against the Vietnam War. And that, it was the best tribute I've ever heard, almost, to The Economist taking a line, provided it argues the line rigorously enough, which it, to use the word the sanitist, it, in my view, that our policy on The Economist, and I said so at the time, was completely wrong. But that was what the leadership felt of The Economist at the time. A lot of us in the paper argued against it, but they argued it so well and so brilliantly that even those of us who were against the Vietnam War at the time respected it because it was so well argued.
I think we have to pack up now because I know Andrew is straight on the beach. I think respect is the important word here, actually. I did find as an environment there was very little backbiting in the paper, possibly because they could argue it all out on Monday mornings and shout at each other, and the fact that the most junior person in the room was free to disagree seriously with the most important person in the room. And I think you've seen that they can do it to each other. I think we all should wish Zanny a lot of luck because it's a tough time. But I hope you find the whole experience as entertaining as obviously your colleagues did. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you.